Welcome back to the Conservatine. I'm your host, Chase Levitt, and today I want to welcome Utah State Representative Trevor Lee onto the show. Thank you so much for sitting down with me.
Thanks, Chase.
Of course. The first thing I want to ask you is just, can you tell everyone a little bit about yourself, who you are, and why you ran for office in the first place?
Yeah, so obviously my name is Trevor Lee. I represent House District 16, which is the northern part of Layton, Utah. It goes up into South Weaver just a little bit and then has a sliver of Clearfield. I have never run for office before, and my experience with politics was helping my mom run for a city council position back in 2014, and had a good opportunity to knock doors, to talk about local issues at the city level. And that was my first intro to helping or being involved with the campaign. Other than I've been a state and county delegate many years. In fact, the first time I was a county delegate was 2008, the year that we ousted Bob Bennett and got, 2010, and got Mike Lee elected. And that was a fun opportunity and a good experience in how the caucus process works and why it's very effective. The other experience I guess I would have is just always being involved as a normal everyday citizen. My parents were really good growing up about having those discussions at the dinner table, something that I highly recommend everyone else do. And making sure that when I was in school, if I had teachers who were liberal or left-leaning, that I knew the issues. And if they were trying to indoctrinate, I had a very good grasp and understanding of what was going on. Fast forward 2020, we had COVID-19 happen. And I was absolutely appalled by our response to COVID. I felt like in that time period, people were so willing to let go of their freedoms, and the fear took hold. And I watched as friends, family, people I know lose their businesses. I watched our children be masked up in schools. And even though Utah's considered one of the best responses to COVID, we still did a horrible job. In no world should we ever have done any of those things in the state of Utah. I mean, America for the most part as well. And being a part of that and going around and still working my job as normal, in fact, that nothing changed for me, I thought it was a joke and was really upset at that time. When I started to look into the record of, at the time, the incumbent, who I eventually ran against, Steve Handy, and how moderate to left-leaning he was for my district. And fast forward to 2022, last year, I decided, hey, if not me, then who? And let me go ahead and run against him. And what's cool about my election is I use the caucus process, the same process that I've been involved in, and I don't believe he took me seriously when I ran for office in this last year. So he didn't gather signatures. We both took it to the delegates, and I got a supermajority of the vote and bypassed any primary and off to the general election. And at that time, he still wouldn't let it go. So he ran a write-in campaign against me in my area for the November election this last year. He lost again, obviously. And so I became elected for the representative of that area. So that's just a little bit about me and my process to getting onto the ballot and becoming a representative.
Well, thanks for sharing. And it sounds like the guy that you ran against was certainly a career politician, thinking he had it all secured, all ready to go, and that he was going to go back to Salt Lake.
Yeah, I mean, he did. I think it took a lot of people by shock. And unfortunately, because of my election, I don't think other politicians will make that mistake now. It's why it's so critical and crucial we can do everything in our power to strengthen the caucus system or get rid of SB 54, one or the other.
Right. I agree. Now, I want to kind of ask you about your experience as a freshman in the legislature. What experiences, what things did you learn? Just if you want to kind of talk about that for a little bit.
Yeah. Two big things that I learned. The first is the civility and the responsible dialogue that we have amongst our legislative body up here. Obviously, as Republicans, being in a red state, we're extremely red. Well, supposedly, but we are red in the fact that we have a majority with Republicans. The yeah. Democrats, while they don't get their way with almost anything, especially if we want to do it, we can. And that's boded our state very well. We're one of the most efficiently fiscally responsible states in the country. We have very low crime. We have a very educated populace. We have big families still comparative to most states. You know, we do a very good job. And I would credit that to our Republican majority legislature. The other thing that I learned is even when we disagree, whether you have Republicans who are running bills or Democrats, the civility and the debate that we have is much better than you have on the outside world. You know, we can disagree up here and still essentially be friends or we get along. And that's something that the real world, I don't think has. People outside of Capitol Hill, they don't do that. I mean, the media is extremely divisive. The ways that people interact on social media, you would never know that there's still a bunch of good debate and civility that goes on in different legislatures around the country and specifically in Utah. I will also say this. I assumed from the outside that if someone was running a bad bill, it's because they had bad intentions. And I would disagree with that. There are bad bills that are run, and there's bills I don't agree with and a lot of bills I do agree with. But I think that everyone has good intentions with what they're trying to do. I never saw anything nefarious going on, at least on the Republican side. And that's not something I thought of. On the outside, I just assumed like, oh, that's a bad bill. Then they must be doing something because George Soros is telling them to, or they're getting lots of money. And I didn't see that. It doesn't mean it's not going on, but it's not something that I personally witnessed. And I came to have a great respect for the colleagues and their desire to want to do good for the state of Utah. Even a lot of Democrats. A lot of Democrats have really good intentions with their bills. I just may not agree with it or their method about which they're going to try to implement their policies that they're proposing.
Right. And that's interesting because, like you said, on the outside, we don't really think of things like that. The media is so divisive. So, like, they want you to be going head to head. And so we don't see that there's actual, you know, good civil debate going on, because from the outside, I'm just like, oh, they're just sitting there yelling at each other. But that's it. That's really interesting to hear. So thanks for sharing that. The next thing I want to talk about is, as a legislator, is your job to, you know, make your district, make the state better as a whole. So I want to ask you, what issues were brought to you the most often from constituents or just people from all around the state? What issues are Utahns most concerned about right now?
Mm-hmm. First and foremost, by far, that was brought to me or even that my constituents had is the inflation and the rampant increase in goods going up. Property tax is a big one. So I would say the economic outlook that the average everyday family has. I can't tell you how many people that would make them feel so much better about either themselves or their sense of security that they have in their lives. And it goes hand in hand with a recent study that came out how what people value is completely changing than what they valued 20 years ago. One of those being, you know, the belief in faith, family, and God. Those kind of things are actually going down in what's considered priority for them. And something that has gone up almost to replace it is money. And so it almost makes sense that so many people were concerned about things that involve their finances and money situation. That was probably the biggest thing that came up. The other one that we had, and this is more of a social issue, but people are very concerned with the direction of the morals and values of our country and then even in our state. So some hot button topics that we had was SB 16, which was a bill to ban the mutilation of children under the age of 18. That was a hot button topic. I had a lot of people that we talked about that in my area and people come to me. And another one, which was rigorously debated and is now happening around the country as well, is school choice. It's the ability to decide what school you want to go to, or if you say, hey, I would rather have money follow my student or my child where they go to school instead of me paying into a system that may not be best for them or that I don't agree with. So we passed HB 215, which was historic in the fact that we've never done anything even close to that in our state, while we simultaneously raised the amount of money that a teacher can make per year. So it did truly help the system as a whole. You have teachers who got a $6,000 pay increase, and you have parents now who can help let money follow their student to their desired choice of education. So those three bills or issues were stuff that were talked about a lot, that I had a lot of input from my constituents either going door to door before the election, and then during a lot of emails from that stuff as well.
Yeah, all those issues are definitely something that I know I'm concerned about and all the people around me are concerned about. And I was just really impressed with how much the legislature got done this session to fix those things, to better those things, stuff like that. So that was awesome. And you had mentioned a little bit earlier, we're going to switch topics a little bit, how Utah is red. And then you said kinda, and I agree with you. Our state for most of our history has been a super red state. But I feel like now that's starting to shift a little bit with politicians that we're putting in at both the state and federal levels. So I want to ask you, why is this happening? Why is Utah coming more to the middle, and what can we do to fix that?
I think the first one is we're becoming complacent here in Utah. You know, we're not a state that has a lot of Democrats in positions of power, but thank goodness, because I feel like those states are horribly run. But then you have a lot of other states that are considered battleground states, or they have close to 50-50 Democrat Republican. I would argue those Republicans are much more red than we are as a state, because they have to fight. They don't take things for granted. They know one bad move can destroy everything that they care about in their state, or one bad policy can change and flip everything in the opposite direction. And so being a supermajority Republican state, we've become very complacent. We take things for granted, and we've become essentially, as history or scriptures have put things, fat and lazy. And that is why we are having a lot of the problems, or why I think we're moving towards more of the middle. And the other issue I would say is our higher ed and our education system. Never in a time have I seen so many of our kids and younger generation get pumped out of the higher ed, or just even their public schools, and come out radicalized on what they believe on their politics. When I was in school, kids didn't want to get involved with politics. It wasn't cool. It wasn't a thing. But now it's so immersed in them at a young age. They get it from the social media. They get it from specifically like their TikToks out of social media. If that's where they're getting their news, then they're getting the wrong kind of education. But then if you get someone who graduates from higher ed and they come out indoctrinated, I mean, you're talking 4 million new troops for the Democratic Party every single year that come out of higher ed. And a lot of those become school teachers. Well, that's the same person who's going to be teaching your kid in the public ed side of things. And somewhere along the line, we have to stop or change that, because that is having a drastic impact on us. As Republicans, because we believe family, God, and we're conservatives, for the most part, we typically don't care about politics. We're not extremely involved. We don't have time to go up and protest. We care about, we have hobbies, we have our families, we're busy with other things. But if you're a Democrat and you're a hardcore activist because you don't have God in your party, you don't believe in that, then your activism is your religion. And that's going to radicalize you to become very involved with the different political parties, your different subjects that you're passionate about. And so they get out there and they protest. They get out there, they take on jobs, and they join these different clubs, and they get on the planning commissions and these different committees, and they infiltrate almost every part of society that we have. And a lot of them don't have kids either. And so whose kids do they try to go after? And a lot of times that's ours. Do a lot of them think they're doing what they believe is right? I'm sure they do. But is it bad for us turning into more moderate, more left-leaning state? Absolutely. It's going to change the way we look at things. And we're already seeing that. If you look at polls and you look at the young kids who are coming up to vote and the younger generations, they're pretty much all Democrats. And that's really hard to watch. That's something we have to get a handle on or a grip very, very quickly. I know Turning Point USA has done a good job about going to college campuses and trying to get younger, especially the college age kids involved. But we have to do something. If we as a Republican majority state are funding these institutions, we need to make sure that we can put a stop to that, the madness, essentially. We're funding those who hate us, which
right.
is really tough.
Right. And Democrats, they do one thing good, and that's getting people involved. And that is, you know, mobilizing their base and getting the youth. And that's something that I've talked to many different people about that we need to focus on here in Utah as Republicans, is getting the youth is, you know, being more going on offense because we played defense for so long. And
correct.
And like you said, the Republicans, many Republicans, not all, many of the Republicans in our state are super complacent, and they just think, okay, we're just going to play the game. And a lot of the times they just go in there to compromise, and they compromise all of our true values. And so that definitely needs to change. So I want to switch to our last topic, which is the flag bill, which has been a huge controversy all across the state for a while now. And I want to ask your opinion on it. I know the way you voted, but I just, if you want to explain that, why you voted the way you did and how this kind of this whole controversy played out.
Mm-hmm. So my area, the incumbent that I beat was the House co-sponsor of the initial flag bill. Going door to door, talking to thousands of people, they were upset with that. And the number one reason why, and it goes back to the first issue that we talked about, was money. What a waste of money. So and I would say it's a small group of people who want the new flag. There really are not that many. In fact, if the roles were reversed right now and you said, hey, you need to go get signatures and get a referendum to change the flag to a new flag, I mean, it would be really hard for them to do that because people wouldn't see the value in it. They don't want to waste the money. And this idea that we need to brand or market ourselves better as a state, I think, is completely false. I mean, right. We have a huge problem with housing because so many people are already moving here. So if they think that that's going to help, you know, more people come here or help with our state's branding or marketing, I disagree completely. I don't want that. And I know most people wouldn't want that. Utah's great the way it is, and it's just fine. We don't need a change. And the flag's history is, it is what it is. It's the history that we've had, whether you like or dislike how it came about and how we have it. There's no need or reason why to waste money to change it. And so that part of it is ridiculous. The other problem that I really have with the flag is so many people, when asked about it, would say, no, don't do it. So I am going to listen to my constituents. Of course, I have a few in my area who want it. In fact, some of the most radical people that want it are in my area, but they're in such a minority. It would be really hard for me to find 20 people in my area who are diehard change the flag.
Yeah.
The rest are like, no. And so why on earth would I go against what the majority of my constituents want? That's just a complete waste of time and money. We don't need to change it. I don't think it should happen. And quite frankly, it's really sad that we're wasting all of this time and energy to go through with it. I really hope it gets on the ballot. I don't know if it will. I mean, it's really hard to get referendums to the ballot to vote on. And so it's just unfortunate. And this whole idea that it's not canceling our flag is not true. It is putting it on the shelf. It really is. Because now when you look at our state, you're going to see the new flag, not our old flag. It's just a historic flag. It sits up there. It comes out every once in a while. But you will be seeing the new flag flying at the Capitol. You're going to see the new flag flying at city buildings, at businesses. And so that will be our state flag. And so it is getting rid of the old flag. It's not going to be flown like it should. And it's hard to watch so many people who are so passionate about this issue now. And that's not for politicians to decide what people are passionate about or not. But because so many are, why don't they listen? I know some of them have their reasons, but a lot of them, and I get it, we have a lot of important issues going on. They just don't care. And so if I say, look, if you don't care, why don't you then listen to what the people who do care about this are saying? And that's my take on the flag.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. And I honestly, I love our old flag, or it's the history behind it, everything. And the new flag doesn't show it at all. It shows the beehive, some mountains, and it's nothing like our other flag. And I agree with you in the fact that we have way more important issues that we should be focusing on. And I think it should have just been put to the ballot in the first place.
Right. Well, and it's become so divisive.
Right.
Right. I would argue there are some good representatives because they voted no on this, or they voted yes on the new flag. I'm sorry. You know, they're going to have a lot of division with some of their most passionate involved voters in their areas. And that's hard to see. One of the reasons, you know, when you talk to the sponsors of this bill, they said one of the reasons they wanted a new flag was to bring people together. help people have some true identity. Like, there's nothing wrong with our current identity, once again. And all this new flag is doing is creating a separation. You have old flag and new flag people at this point. And that's done the complete opposite, once again, of one of the purposes of the quote unquote new flag. And so that's, once again, it proves it's a waste of time and money. And it's causing more division than what it would have had they not even touched this issue.
Exactly. And it's specifically dividing the Republican Party.
Yes.
Among us, because you have those who are diehard new flag and those who absolutely hate it. And it's just causing this division that is totally just not necessary, where we could be talking about so many other things that are actually affecting our lives. And they simply just would rather erase history and bring in this new flag.
Yeah, and it's sad to watch. It really is.
I agree. So that's all that I have to talk about today. And I want to thank you for sitting down with me and talking with me about all of it. And I thank you for all your work that you do in the legislature, and wish you the best of luck in the future and so on.
Thanks, Chase. Thanks for all you do as well.
Yep, appreciate thank it. You.